Looks like we got Eric. There you are. How's it going?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing very well. What's your backdrop? What's behind you?
Oh, just a bookshelf with a variety of different things on it. Some knickknacks collected over the years and travels, and obviously a handful of books. Some baseball, some not baseball.
We get that question a lot from our audiences. They're very perceptive of what people have behind them.
So there's just to give a sampling then a Ty Cobb biography.
Really?
That's on the shelf. I've got the Lyndon Johnson 4-volume set by Robert A. Caro, which I started last year. And I'm currently working on Truman by David McCullough, which won the Pulitzer Prize 20 some years ago. So, like I said, there's a healthy mixture of politics and sports. Not current politics, but politics from long ago.
How do you feel Doris Kearns Goodwin stacks up in terms of historical biographers?
I can listen to her talk about Lincoln or Lyndon Johnson, who she actually worked for. I think she was a fellow when she was at Harvard, I believe, in the Johnson White House. I can listen to her talk about, pretty much anything all day long. And obviously, she's a huge baseball fan as well. But her team of rivals, the book on Lincoln, was is as good as it gets.
Sean Clancy's already got questions, so let's
yeah, I'm
we'll
sure he does.
The show and then we'll jump into the questions. And for everybody that has questions for Eric, you can put them in the comments, or there's the little question mark at the bottom. Welcome back. Right now, the show's called Baseball People on the New York Pro Scouts channel. I'm Jesse, and we are live on this channel every Monday and Thursday. Today's exciting guest is Erik Boland, Yankees beat writer for Newsday. You worked at the Warren Tribune in Ohio. You graduated from John Carroll University. You went to NYU for journalism. Introduce yourself to everyone. Talk about how you got to know scouts over the years.
Well, this is my 12th year covering the Yankees, and covered the Jets for a year before that, the Brett Favre year, which was an adventure in of itself, just the whole season. And then right after the 2009 draft, Cat O'Brien, who covered the Yankees for Newsday before me, left the paper, left the business. Actually, for some reason, she didn't see growth in the newspaper field and left the business, and that was that. And Newsday put me on the Yankees beat, and so I just sort of gradually, in all honesty, I saw, who covered the Yankees, and you see, there's a lot of people on the beat that had been covering them for a long time, led by George King of the New York Post, who still covers the Yankees, and pretty much everyone in the audience who's a scout knows who George is. And I watched George interact on a daily basis with scouts, and I said, well, this guy seems pretty plugged in, meaning George, and I just sort of not tailed him around because it's a competitive situation, but you couldn't help but notice who he was talking to and how often and how frequently during spring training he was talking to those guys. And I just sort of, periodically, and George has still forgotten more scouts, I think, than I know. But, over the years, I can't introduce myself to enough of them because there's just so much you can learn from them. And one of my favorite things to do during the spring is to sit in the scouts table in the back of the lunchroom at Steinbrenner Field and do as much listening as possible, because and it's a line I've said to scouts over the years, I can learn a lot more from you than you can from me.
So we're going to get into that in depth, and it's very true. I think you learn a lot in this game around the right people listening. Before we jump in, there are some fun and inventive names of minor league teams. One of the quirks of our show is that we allow our guests to name the show. So the Toledo Mudhens, the Akron Rubber Ducks, Columbus Clippers, Joe Rigoli, pro scout for the Cardinals and the president of the Hot Stove Association, called it Baseball People. It had a good run. Erik, what should we call the show?
The show that I'm on?
Yep, right now.
Oh, my. I'll take any audience suggestions on that one.
All right, so we'll take some suggestions and we can come back to that, pick the show title at the end. But we'll jump into it. So you're a media professional and you talk with a lot of sources. You are probably hearing a lot of things as we all are, but help us cut through what we're hearing and understand both sides of this will baseball come back debate right now. And what is everyone hoping to accomplish?
Well, I mean, look, there's been a lot of dialogue. Some's been leaked in the media, more so from what the owner's proposal is going to be or has been. I mean, they're still in the very beginning stages, obviously, the Players Association and the owners. But in the end, they do have a central point to rally around, which is it's in both parties' interest for there to be a season of some kind. And so that's why even as you see the sides sort of retreating their respective corners on certain issues, that those things have already leaked out. You come back to the middle on the standpoint that both sides are losing an awful lot of money. Both sides have a vested financial interest in there being some kind of a season played. And so, even though a lot of the dialogue at the moment is pessimistic, I'm optimistic that there will be a form of a season. I'm not sure exactly what form that's going to take, but when you have two negotiating parties and both of their stake is financial, particularly in these uncharted circumstances that we're in, I have to believe that splitting up minor profits is still, both sides would rather do that than right. Be splitting up no profits at all.
So as far as leaking things out there, MLB, when they wanted to, let's say, throw a test balloon, and this happens in politics with the minor league system earlier in the year, when they wanted to get the public opinion on that, they somehow it got out there. We've just kind of seen it again with this, where the owners all agree and that came out. Can you talk about what their thought process is in doing that and how that plays out in the court of public opinion?
Yeah, I mean, I think like the very first plan that came out, it was a little bit amusing. It leaked out on it was a Sunday night or a Monday night. I don't remember exactly the day. The days blend together as all of us have been quarantined for the last 6 to 8 weeks or so. But, it leaked out on, let's say, a Sunday night, and it was clearly from Major League Baseball, from that side of it. And the next morning, they're distancing themselves from the report with a statement. So I thought that was kind of funny. But, it's not always a nefarious thing. To quote FDR from the Great Depression, he said, and I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but he said, in the end, by all means, at least try something. And so the fact that very early on, you had a bunch of stuff getting thrown against the wall, a lot of which probably was not realistic, but that there were ideas being thrown out there. There were discussions. There were let's just throw stuff out there and see if 10% of it sticks or is feasible or is reasonable. And we all know the virus is going to have the final say so on any of this stuff. I don't think that it was necessarily a negative thing, but yeah, I mean the way the sausage is made, to use that cliche, sometimes you kind of have to sit back and smile. And I thought the Arizona plan, which was the very first one that came out a number of weeks ago, it was funny that it was leaked, and within 12 hours, Major League Baseball was distancing itself essentially from its own leak.
Who do you think's at bigger advantage in terms of negotiating this deal? Who's going to give first?
That's a great question, Jesse, and I don't think anyone has an answer to that. I mean, you could make an argument for each side. Ultimately, and the cliche born from the 94-95 strike, that bled into the 95 season, was millionaires against billionaires.
Right.
And, ultimately, the billionaires have more money. And so I would say that they have a slight advantage, if you will, and from the PR standpoint, and you can never discount that, even though everybody always says that doesn't matter. But in the history of labor negotiations, and I've never understood this, but it's been true throughout baseball history, in general, fans always side with the owners. And so, I think generally speaking, and if you just look at the values of the respective franchises, I think the owners could more easily, not easily, but more easily survive a season with no baseball than the players at large could.
We got a couple of audience questions on the subject. So Billy Blitzer wants to know, would writers be at the ballpark covering games?
Billy, that's obviously that's something that all of us are interested in. I've heard mixed reviews, if you will, on that, or mixed messages. The latest is that they are going to try to find a way to have writers in there, but I think that's going to be one of the last things that's negotiated, frankly, and should be. I mean, you know, I think we do need to take stock of our relative importance in things, and obviously, my organization, Newsday, is going to want to know that there's certain protocols that would keep me or anyone else from Newsday that covers baseball, whether it's a reporter or a photographer, that would keep us safe, and anybody else, you know, that covers the Yankees or covers sports. It's their respective organizations would have, you know, similar concerns, but you know, what they do with the print media is probably pretty low on the totem pole right now in terms of the negotiations between the players and the management, and again, you know, probably rightfully so.
Well, and it's good. I'm sure you saw Sean Doolittle's tweets and that whole thing. I think where scouts are going to be, where the concessionaires are going to be, the writer, it's on people's minds, which is good. But yeah, they're not the first ones thought about. And
let me be clear. I mean, I certainly, I would push to do so, whatever the final plan ends up being. I cover the Yankees. It's my job. I miss my job. I love my job. All of the people, you know, watching and listening, I know it's probably primarily scouts and I've texted with a lot of them during this, and you know, we all want to get back to the ballpark, but I think we all agree we want to get back you know, safely as well. But you know, once a plan is hopefully nailed down, you know, I certainly will be, you know, on the phone with the people I need to be on the phone with at Newsday, saying yes, I think I should go.
So for now, last question on this pandemic and the restructuring and how we come back, but how do you think that overall, when we're looking back on this, if you had to guess now, this would affect the game big picture?
If there's no agreement, I mean, I think you're looking at something similar to what happened in 94 or 95, and it took the sport a long time to kind of extricate itself from that, and I think it might even be made worse this year, and again, if the season doesn't occur because of the virus, that's something different. Nobody's going to blame anybody for that. If the reason there's no season is because the owners and the players can't agree on finances, I think you're looking at, you know, potential long-term damage to the game that was incurred back in 94, 95. I don't think that's ultimately going to be the case. And if there is a season of some kind, let's say it's 80, 82 games, whatever, 14 teams in the playoffs, which is, you know, one of the proposals or part of the owner's proposal, you know, people are going to affix all sorts of asterisks to the season and say illegitimate champion, et cetera, et cetera. And then 5 years from now, it'll just be Team X won the 2020 World Series in extenuating circumstances. And that's, as history goes on, that's how it ultimately will be remembered. And it will be remembered as an overwhelmingly positive thing that in the midst of all of this, baseball was able to come back. So I actually, the people that are very negative on, oh, you can't have a half season and it's not legitimate, et cetera, et cetera, I think that's a very short-sighted viewpoint on it, because as I said, the further we get away from this, it'll just be seen as exceedingly positive that baseball was able to have any kind of a season and crown a champion. And it will not be seen as illegitimate. Maybe, you know, in November or December it will be, but right, you know, 2-3 years from now, again, it'll just be Team X won the 2020 World Series.
And wants to know, was it easier, or what's the difference between covering football and baseball, and was it easier to cover Favre or Jeter?
Well, the access doesn't compare in terms of football and baseball, and what's kind of funny, and I was guilty of this too, I always thought that Major League Baseball was the most media friendly of sports to cover, or one of the more media friendly, and that baseball was the most difficult, because from the outside, and this was an outsider's perspective that I had before starting to cover the Yankees, was that baseball players were so difficult, the people inside the game were so difficult, et cetera, to deal with. And the NFL has this great reputation as being so easy to deal with. And it's actually, you have much less access in football than you do with baseball players. And an example that I used many, many times was, when Kellen Clemens was a quarterback with the Jets, a name maybe forgotten to history, a very nice guy, by the way, but when he was a starting quarterback for X number of games, he talked exactly 2 days a week, and you would have public relations people that would keep you from talking to him if it wasn't one of his, quote, designated days to talk. He would talk on Sundays, obviously, after the game, and he would talk on, let's say, Tuesday or Wednesday. Well, not Tuesday because it's a league-mandated off day, but Wednesday or Thursday or Friday would be his designated day to speak. I could talk to Derek Jeter, who's a star of the proportions 100,000 times more than Kellen Clemens. Right. I had access to Derek Jeter 7 days a week. He was always in the clubhouse pre or post game. And so I've used that example when I've been asked a form of that question, which was, here's Derek Jeter, Hall of Famer, Yankees icon, et cetera, et cetera. And, it doesn't mean great interview and doesn't mean, illuminating quotes, et cetera. We're just talking strictly from an access standpoint. You couldn't get near Kellen Clemens or any other player to barely say hello before getting intercepted by a public relations person that didn't think that you should be over there. Whereas Derek Jeter was fair game 7 days a week. I didn't want that, and he certainly didn't want it, but the access was there and is there for the most part with baseball players. That's just isn't there with football. I haven't covered any of the other sports as a beat, so I can't speak to those. But just comparing it for Sean's question, baseball and football, it's not even close. I won't say it's easier to cover baseball, but again, the access is far better, and it's not a competition.
So you're from Cleveland, and then when you first came over, like you're saying, you were covering the Jets and that Brett Favre season, and then you quickly got switched over to covering the Yankees, which you didn't want to do at the time. Can you talk about why that was, and then how do you feel about it now, or what's changed?
Yeah, so it's good research on your part to come up with that. I think I know where you got that from, but so yeah, and it was no secret at Newsday. I fought the sports editor Hank Winicki, who still is, thankfully, the sports editor at Newsday, wanted to switch me from the Jets to the Yankees, and it wasn't an anti-baseball thing. It was more, as you mentioned, I was born and raised in Cleveland, and anyone familiar with Cleveland knows that in terms of the sports hierarchy there, it's the Cleveland Browns number one, and everyone else is not at the bottom, but it's the Browns number one, Browns offseason number two, Browns draft number three, and then the Cavs and Indians kind of fight it out, and then you can never discount Ohio State football either. But, even when LeBron was at his height, it still didn't compare and doesn't compare to the interest in the Browns. So growing up in that environment where the NFL is far and away the most intensely followed and covered sport, when I was covering the Jets, in my mind, I was covering the NFL. And so even the Yankees being the Yankees, and I certainly understood what the Yankees as a franchise represent, it still was, I'm covering the NFL. Why do I want to go for cover Major League Baseball, even if it is the Yankees? So it was short-sighted on my part. I did not particularly, I was completely underwater in that 2009 season, and probably through 10 and 11 also. Maybe I started treading water by 2012 covering the Yankees. But I do to this day, whenever I go into the office, which is usually about once a year, and I'll have a sit down with Hank Winicki, the sports editor. And every year since then, I have thanked him for forcing me to cover the Yankees. The line I've used to him and I've used to other people is that, he had to drag me kicking and screaming onto the Yankees beat, and he would have to drag me kicking and screaming off of the Yankees beat.
So we have kids who watch this that are interested in sports, parents and fans. We have, a little bit of everybody. What advice would you give? Because you say you were drowning at first, and it's reasonable. It's a huge task. Who and what helped you get through, and what advice would you give to someone who wants to get into this?
What got me through it was, part of it is the access the sport gives you. There's a game every day. The news replenishes itself every day. So there's always somebody to meet, always somebody new to meet, to get to know, to talk to. And eventually, you know, you hope that it you can establish trust with people and that they'll start to, you know, tell you what's going on and what's really going on. And one piece of great advice that George King from the Post gave me was cover your team, whoever it may be, from the outside in. And one example that he used was, you know, every team. And again, talking to scouts, you know, everybody, you know, probably will nod their head when I say this. You know, every team values their own players in the minor leagues. They all love their own prospects. And George's advice was get to know scouts from other teams that cover the Yankees to really get an idea of what the game, what the sport thinks of a given prospect. Because the Yankees are just going to tell you positive things for the most part about all of their prospects. And if you have a cross section of, you know, 7, 8, 9 guys, however it may be, from other organizations that cover the Yankees organization, maybe you get a truer sense of a player. That's just one of many examples, but covering your organization from the outside in, I thought was a great piece of advice from George. In terms of general advice, I always tell young people on this one is, first and foremost, never say no to an assignment. You know, when you're, you know, young and starting off and there's a girls lacrosse game that they want you to cover and you've never seen a lacrosse game in your life and they say want you to go cover it. Don't tell them, I'm not familiar with girls lacrosse. Just go and figure it out. Go talk to people. And if you have to play dumb, and I did that plenty of times, trust me, I had never seen it. I'm using that as a specific example because I ended up as when I did high school. I did high schools at Newsday for almost 6 years as a part-timer, excuse me, before I got hired full-time. I did a lot of girls lacrosse and sports that other reporters didn't necessarily want to do. I learned to love it, by the way. Some of the best interviews are girls lacrosse players. But, you know, I would tell them, I don't know anything about your sport, and I apologize, and that's on me. But the only way I can write about it intelligently is if you help me. And I would do that with players. I would do that with coaches. And I would like to think that I had at least, you know, some semblance of success doing that. And that went for lacrosse. That went for swimming meets. It went for fencing. It went for an equestrian event that I covered on the east end of Long Island one time. And you know, the list goes on and on. Never say no to an assignment because when, you know, the Knicks beat reporter suddenly can't go to Minneapolis, you might be on the list at the last minute that they say, hey, can you get on a flight tomorrow morning and go to Milwaukee or Minneapolis? And that's an example that happened to me when I was a part-timer or, you know, we didn't need an extra person to go to Shinnecock Hills to help out on our U.S. Open coverage or to Bethpage Black to help out on our U.S. Open coverage or the U.S. Open tennis tournament, you know, in Queens. You know, the list kind of goes on and on to get those big plum assignments that we all want and all want to be a part of. You know, you need to show a willingness and an openness to do a lot of other things too.
And I think it applies to at least all of the writers that I know. I think of, or you know, in media, you think of Bob Costas or Joe Buck. They've done their fair share of random things, or Bob Wolf, who is like a titan of the industry years right. ago. He worked at News 12, so you probably, before he passed, right. met.
I did, Bob. Absolutely. A legend. There's a sweetheart of a guy, too. And had you talk about a guy that had stories.
Yeah, oh my God. Drinking beer on TV, spitting it into a bucket on the side while he was calling games. But, you know, he started with the Westminster Dog Show. And that, at first, was probably like, I don't know, nothing. He could have turned that down, and he made it into an institution. I mean, he called it for 40 years, so... You never know what it's going to be. I think you're totally, totally right on that.
Another piece of advice too, by the way, sorry to interrupt, no, Jesse, is that and it kind of goes along with this is, and I struggle with this because I'm 46, so I'm closer to the you know, the end of my career than the beginning. I've been doing this in some form or another since 22 years old. Is be flexible, and. When, you know, I fought, and I'll stand up and say it, you know, I fought the internet in the, you know, mid-2000s when they wanted stuff posted right away. And I would be like, no, I need to take 2 hours to craft the perfect story. And they're saying, no, we need something for the web like 10 minutes after it happens. You know, write two paragraphs and then you can take the time to write a full story. And I pissed and moaned and complained about that and fought City Hall, if you will. And I learned, I won't say the hard way, because I did adapt, thankfully. And that goes with, you know, Twitter. I did not embrace Twitter right away, or Facebook, or and Instagram, which I one I finally started last night for this. But for the most part, I've been fairly flexible. The spring training, they wanted me to do post workout videos, to post to Newsday's website. That's something 5, 6, 7, 10 years ago, I would have laughed at and said, I don't have time to do a video after I work, get to the ballpark at 7 in the morning and write till 6 or 7 at night. I don't have time to shoot a video. Now I shoot a video. And you just have to be flexible and realize that people consume information and consume their news in a variety of platforms. And I'm by no means fluent in all of them, but I'm not a lot more fluent in more than I used to be. That's for sure.
Christy says you're an excellent tweeter, so that's a good seal of approval.
Well, that is a good seal of approval, because Christy is A+.
So you're doing a great job of leading me into my next thought here, but the media landscape's very different in 2020 than it was when you first started in the mid-90s in Ohio. So how have you met that demand personally? Was that part of why you were drowning? So how have you adapted, and how has it changed over time?
Well, the immediacy, there's no time to, a story breaks, and it usually breaks on Twitter. Very few things are held for the morning newspaper anymore. I mean, there's exceptions, but they're rare. Something breaks on Twitter. You play catch up, and if you have something, you don't sit on it. You're not going to try to craft turn a 300 word story into a perfect 600 word story or whatever. If there's a piece of information, you put it out there, and then you fill in from there. That's something that when I was at John Carroll in the mid 90s and graduating in 96 and then working at the Warren Tribune, that's a world that I would not have even, envisioned. I was still typing on one of those tiny Radio Shack computers in 1997 or 98 when covering Indians games for the Warren Tribune, where it only showed 5 lines of text at a time. It's a completely different landscape, and it's an ever-changing landscape. I mean, how we're covering sports now, or pre-pandemic, I don't think it is going to really mirror what we're doing 5 or 10 years from now. I wish I knew exactly what that was going to be. I don't even think we can necessarily envision it. And I do wonder, and I have no answer for this. I wonder if the current pandemic that we're going through now is going to institute a lot of changes to the way sports are covered. I suspect that it will, but I'm not exactly sure. That's above my pay grade to figure out, the logistics of that. But I do suspect that there's going to be a lot of changes in the sports media industry based on what we're going through right now.
Let's just take a quick detour. What is it with John Carroll, which is a small school, and football players and football coaches more so than play? I mean, London Fletcher, but you've got Don Shula and Greg. You got all these coaches. What's the deal?
Yeah, that's a good, and there's a lot. There's a handful of GMs, and Nick Caserio, who's a high ranking guy with the Patriots and player personnel. I'm not sure what his title is, and he's been there for a long time. Him and I were actually in the same sports journalism elective class at John Carroll. Nick was a year younger than me. I actually ran into him when I was a general assignment reporter for Newsday. Oh, I want to say 2005 or 2006. I was in Foxborough doing a sidebar on a Jets Patriots game. This is before I was on the beat, and Nick came walking through the press box, and we kind of, I knew he was there, and he wouldn't, and we kind of said, caught up for a few minutes, and that was that. But I don't know the answer to that. Dave Caldwell is a GM also. Polian is a huge name, of course. And Brian Polian was on the one of the Carroll football teams that I covered in the mid-90s when I was there. Caldwell was also on that team. Tom Telesco. That whole mid-90s John Carroll team had a whole bunch. Nick Caserio was the quarterback for 3 of those years. It's a heck of a coincidence, but I guess we'll just track it all back to Don Shula, because it all started with him.
Yeah, We've got a quick question here. Eric, what did baseball writers do in the quarantine? Anthony from Detroit.
Oh, that must be Anthony Fennec asking that question. They're probably the same things in New York that they're doing in Detroit.
And that is waiting.
Yes, exactly. Waiting to see when we get to go back to work. I mean, the interesting thing, and I much prefer to be having a season 100%, but this does test your creativity somewhat. And I know, you know, Christy, who's become a good friend over the years with the Daily News, her and I have texted about this. We are, our respective newspapers are still publishing 7 days a week. They still have space to fill, and they still want content, and they still want baseball content. And so it tests you somewhat. And so you reach out to scouts, you reach out to executives, you reach out to whoever you can think of to try to give you, 400, 500, 600 words to get you through, a given day. And it tests your creativity. And it also, tests your networking of sourcing. Sources, to be able to come up with something at least 4, 5, maybe 6 days a week to fill the paper, because everybody's struggling right now, and the paper must go on. Right. For those of us that still work in papers, they're still publishing, and it's our responsibility, to try to come up with stuff, and it is a challenge. But I feel much better about being able to do that now, compared to, let's say 2, 3 years ago, or my first, couple of years when I was telling you, I felt completely underwater. That was when the games were going on.
Right.
I can't imagine being a first or second year beat reporter and having to do this. I'm not by saying any means that I'm acing this test, but I'm in a far better position to do it now than I would have been 10, 11 years ago, and certainly when I started in 2009.
So with the kind of immediate demands we're talking about, how do you end up finding a work-life balance, especially baseball, 162 games, the offseason, there's a whole another just 3 months worth of coverage, so it never really ends. How do you decompress? Are you allowed to turn your phone off, or is that like a cardinal sin? How does that go?
Well, in season it's difficult, and you kind of take your R&R where you can get it. I do every road trip with the Yankees, so I do all 81 games on the road. Home, it's a 5-day work week, so you get random days off. Maybe a Tuesday and a Thursday one week. Maybe it's a Friday, Saturday. You take the break where you can get it. But Newsday is very generous with all of the baseball writers in terms of vacation time. I get basically 9 weeks of vacation. Which is a lot, and it's terrific. And I've been able to do some great traveling over the years in the off season. And that's, that kind of keeps you sane, and it allows you, having that chunk of time off in the off season, there's never been one onset of February where I haven't been recharged and ready to head to Tampa for spring training. I've never dreaded it and said, oh geez, the calendar just turned into February, and man, now I've got the grind of 6, 7 weeks of spring training, and then 162 game season, and then the postseason, etc. I've never once felt drained going into a given season, and it's because I do get a nice chunk of time off in the off season. And again, that's a credit to Newsday, because I know, having done this a long time and know a lot of reporters with different organizations, I'm in the minority on that one. I don't know how the men and women that get 2 weeks vacation time do this job. I don't know. I think you'd get burned out pretty quickly doing that. But fortunately for me, knock on wood, that hasn't happened.
Anthony Fennec says that if your editor is watching, they want you to stream the virtual Yankees. the Mets have had their announcers kind of doing some of those. What do you think? You want to do that? Is that in your interest?
I don't think so. But if I'm asked to,
you will,
by people other than Anthony,
right?
I'll do it. I'm in. I'm willing to try anything.
So you're married to an amazing baseball journalist in Marley Rivera. So what is that dynamic like? Do you feed each other scoops or how does that go?
No, absolutely not. But I'll tell you a funny story about that. And you're right. And I am biased. But yes, she is an amazing journalist. But at the winter meetings a number of years ago, we were in Washington. It was 11:30, quarter to 12, something like that. And we're about to, go to bed. And I shut my computer down, and all of a sudden Marley's phone dinged because she got a text, and she just looked at me and she said, take out your computer. And, because a player who was going to sign with the Yankees had texted her to let her know that. Stuff like that. But like anybody else, I have to wait until that's not my scoop. So to answer your question, no, we don't share scoops with each other, but that would be very one-sided.
Fair enough.
She would be doing a lot more sharing with me than I would with her.
It's good to have that on your team. So New York has some pretty powerful, I was just thinking about this, sports journalism couples, Anthony McCarron and Judy Batista, Christy and Sean. Sean writes blogs for Clancy's or for Foley's, so I think that counts.
Sean is a de facto sports journalist. There's no question about that.
He's a de facto scout as well and umpire.
Don't forget the umpires.
Yeah, can you scout the playing field here for sports journalists and couples? What is it about finding love here in this place?
I hadn't really thought of that, but it is a funny dynamic. But you because of these jobs and scouts know this better than anyone because of the intense travel and scouts really don't have home games like we at least. Covering a beat, we do get 81 home games, scouts, umpires really don't have that. You meet who you meet and where does that pool come from? It's who you see during the day, on most days. And so, that's the pool from which you, you select from. And, that meeting Marley was the best thing that ever happened to me. Getting the Yankees beat professionally was the best thing that ever happened to me. And meeting Marley was the best thing personally ever that happened to me. And, so it's liar. She's in the background saying liar. We're in a small New York City apartment. So, there's not a lot of secrets. So,
Sean and Christy seem to be pretty happy they didn't get that question and only you did. So
yeah. Well Judy and Anthony probably, take top billing on that one, just based on Judy alone.
yeah, especially they've got the football baseball dynamic going as well.
Yes.
Let's do another audience question here. So have you ever interviewed the Yankees old first base coach Tony Pena?
Yeah, I love Tony Pena. Tony Pena is one of my favorite people that I, was privileged enough to meet over the years covering the Yankees, and just an absolute sweetheart of a guy, not a mean bone in his body. Obviously, his playing career speaks for itself, but as great as a player he was, and as good as a coach as he was. Even a better person, Tony Pena, and he's a guy that I would stay occasionally in the team hotel. He would embarrass active players with his workout regimen. Anyone that's ever seen Tony Pena on a treadmill never forgot it, or never has forgotten it.
We had an audience question about the Jets and if they have been inept from top to bottom, but do you think that they've made changes or do you not have that perspective anymore?
I have to say that whoever asked that question probably knows a lot more about the Jets than I do. I will, though, just as a general, and I've tweeted this before, offer this, that when I started in the business, and I'm going to go on a little bit of a tangent, but it kind of relates to the listener's question. When I started in the business at 22, 23 years old, a gentleman, I was covering the expansion Browns, and somebody with the Browns said to me, young man, I don't know how long you're going to be doing this, but let me give you a truism throughout the history of sports. It's true now. It's true 100 years ago, it'll be true 100 years from now. You can't fix bad ownership. And again, just generally speaking, I'm not impugning anybody. If you look at the bad franchises in all sports across the board, the one thing they all have in common is bad ownership.
We know.
And that's what I've always the Browns have experienced that. The Jets have experienced that. I won't say, and I'll just leave it at that. But I think if any, we're all sports fans, so everybody watching this, listening, et cetera, are all sports fans. Think of the bad franchises in the sports, and one thing they all have in common, generally speaking, is bad ownership.
I'm going to put two things in your head, and we'll pick it at the end, but Sean suggested Boland's Bylines.
I saw that on the comment section, and I think, I haven't been reading each
Jim Cuthbert
and every one, but that's
Marley
pretty good.
Me. So if you like that one.
Yeah, oh, that's pretty good, too, yeah.
So think about it. We'll come back to it.
Boy, yeah, so leave it to Jimmy. I would share with the audience what Jimmy texted me earlier today when he saw that I was going to be on this today. But, I'll just leave that between me and Jimmy and our Lord and Savior.
Fair enough. So you're covering the Yankees. You're not a Yankees fan, right? You didn't grow up a Yankees fan. But you want stories to happen. You want things to cover. You want it to be interesting. What is that experience like as a writer, even in regards to, the people around you that maybe don't understand how that works? Talk to the dynamics, not being a fan, but rooting for things, and how does that go?
Yeah, it is a misconception that, and not just with people who cover the Yankees, I think that just beat reporters in general, and I know that any beat reporter, I know Anthony Fenech certainly has experienced this in Detroit, and Christie certainly at the Daily News, and anyone else that might be watching this, there's this myth that all of us won some kind of I'm the greatest Yankee fan contest to get the jobs that we have, or I'm the biggest Tigers fan contest, or the biggest Mets fan, to get these jobs as beat reporters. And that's not the case. We have these jobs for a variety of reasons. And none of them have to do with being fans of the team. And I would say the vast, vast, vast majority of people that, whether they cover hockey or basketball, baseball, football, are not fans of the teams that they cover. It's a job. It's a great job. I love the job. As I said earlier, I don't want to do anything else. I want to do this until, I'm time to retire, et cetera. So it's something that, every day I enjoy doing, and can't wait to be able to do it the way we're supposed to again soon. But it is a job, and you root for good stories. You don't root for results. And, the joke that I've used with people before is that if I got a playoff share, then I would root for the Yankees, then that would, you're putting, money in my pocket. But I get paid the same whether the Yankees win or lose, whether they make the playoffs or not, whether they lose in the first round or lose in the wild card or win the World Series or lose in the ALCS, whatever. I get paid the same. So, you root for, and Steve Marcus, a longtime Newsday writer who just retired this past year, another one of my mentors at Newsday, said to me very early on, you always root for your beat. It doesn't necessarily mean for the team, but you root for your beat in terms of interesting stories. And so, and Marley has said this before, she roots for quick games. and I think that anyone who covers baseball can certainly associate with that. Scouts as well, by the way. But you want to see interesting people doing interesting things. And that's really, why we do this, to be able to chronicle the unexpected or the surprising or whatever it may be. And it's not necessarily always within the black and white construct of wins and losses. Now, I will say this. I think it's easier to cover a winning team than a losing team.
Right.
But that doesn't mean that you're rooting for wins and losses.
I'm a masochist. When I was working for baseball, and it was different because I was doing the broadcast end of things, as soon as it got to extra innings, because I just wanted to be a part of history, I was rooting for the longest game in history every time.
You're sick, Jesse.
Yes, I totally am. But when we got there, it was like, all right, if we're going to do this, let's just do it.
Well, it's funny when you mentioned that, that jogged memory in my head. You know, the World Series game, the Red Sox and Dodgers a few years ago, the 18 inning game, it did reach a point in that one where it was so absurd, you kind of did want it to just keep going on because you knew, you know, I love being at the ballpark or, you know, I mean, obviously I've covered predominantly baseball the last 12 years, but fortunate to cover some other big events before that. You know, there are certain moments that unfold in front of you where you realize in that moment that you're seeing something that people 10, 15, 20, 25 years from now are going to talk about and are going to remember. And that 18 inning World Series game, you know, that ended, I think at what was it, 3:45 in the morning, East Coast time, something absurd like that. You know, when you got to like the 15th inning, you realized that you were, you know, being in Dodger Stadium that night, that was one of those type of, you know, games or moments, however you want to define it. And that's very cool. So, yes, I do, as much as we all kind of joke about hating extra inning games and those, you know, 5-6 hour marathons, which, you know, we generally do.
With the Yankees. In the right,
yeah, you're right. Yeah, that's a typical just Sunday night game at Fenway Park between the Yankees and Red Sox. But in very, very occasional circumstances, it's not the worst thing in the world, and actually can be thrilling.
So let's do rapid fire. I'm gonna throw some things out. You tell me the first answer or whatever comes to your mind. Okay.
Go.
Drew Carey or Iron Chef Michael Simon?
Drew Carey.
Okay. Favorite winter Olympic sport?
Curling.
Favorite ice cream flavor?
All of them, but. I worked in a homemade ice cream and candy store when I was in high school and for a couple of years in college, and
that's
I'm addicted
dangerous.
To it. But I guess I had to pick one, gun to head, chocolate.
Would you rather be forced to dance every time you heard music or be forced to sing along to any song you heard?
Oh boy. And Marley can attest to this. I'm a zero tool player on both fronts. I would say dance. I would rather dance than sing.
Best press box in baseball?
Camden Yards. But San Francisco, close second.
You did well on that part. We're going to move on to the coronavirus in spring training and your experience with it. So the Yankees were kind of one of the first teams directly affected by it. Can you talk about what that was like and what your spring training coronavirus experience was?
Yeah, I mean, that was kind of a shocking, you know, thing when the news broke that one of their minor leaguers had tested positive. And you remember 2 or 3 days later, a second one of their minor leaguers tested positive. And I remember texting with a couple of both employees on the minor league side of the Yankees and also with some minor league players. It's not overstating things to say that they were fairly, I don't want to say scared to death. That's probably overplaying it a little bit, but you know, they were on pins and needles about, well, geez, if we had two people that tested within positive within a 3 or 4 day stretch, we're gonna have a real, you know, anyone that's been in the Yankees minor league complex, you know, you've got 150 players crammed in there for minor league spring training, and not, you know, there's four fields and it's fairly spacious, and they did a whole multi-million dollar renovation a number of years ago there. But still, you know, you've got a lot of people crammed in a, you know, in a relatively small space. There was a real fear that if two guys were tested positive in such a short amount of time, that you'd have a real, you know, spread like wildfire type of situation. Obviously, that, you know, turned out not to be the case. But I do remember, you know, like I said, texting with a number of people on that side of things, and even some of the big leaguers too, because as you guys know, during the course of a spring training, you get the minor league call up guys that'll come over for big league spring training games. They get in the, you know, seventh, eighth, ninth inning, whatever, and they interact with big leaguers. And you also have big league players to get extra work in. We'll go over to the minor league side. Whether to throw BP or participate in an inter-squad spring game, whatever it may be.
Or
so,
just look at Raymond James Stadium.
Or just, whatever the reason might be. So, yeah, I mean, there was a period of time where, you know, there was some real concern about, you know, how widespread this thing might take off through, you know, the minor leagues and maybe even the big league clubhouse. Fortunately for everyone involved, that, you know, that wasn't the case.
So what's the best thing that's happened to you since you've been home from spring training with this?
I would say, you know, and people will laugh and think that I'm being, you know, cornball on this, but, you know, Marley and I have never spent this much time together. and so it's been, and she might have a different answer and probably does.
Maybe we'll get her on and she can also answer that.
Yes. Yeah. But it's been, you know, being able to spend as much time as we have where, because, you know, she was on the Yankees beat for a number of years, but for really for the last four or so, she's been, or maybe five, been a national writer. We very rarely cross paths during the season, other than, you know, maybe two or three days every 2 weeks. And so, you know, we spend an awful lot of time, insert punchline here, about too much time. I won't insert that line. But yeah, I mean, just being able to spend every day, you know, quality time, even though we are both working, but with Marley and she's an amazing baker. And
what's the best thing she bakes?
Well, just off the top, there is an amazing key lime pie. From a couple of weeks ago, and just this morning, some just delicious biscuits.
Wow! All right.
That, and that's just naming two. I do pull the load occasionally. I have a salmon and potatoes dish that I do, and well, I guess that's about it. But you know, that is
perfected
probably about
it. Stick with
it. I will say I have perfected the potatoes. Not as easy as one might think.
No. So now we're going to do the second fun little segment here, baseball cards. So I'm just going to show you cards. You tell me the first thing that comes to mind about the player, Zach Britton.
Amazing to talk to in the clubhouse.
The next one is Paul O'Neill.
The Warrior. And a fun broadcast. I don't get to listen to as many games on the Yes Network because I'm covering a lot. But you know, anytime I'm watching a Yankees game and he's doing the game, you know, you can't help but smile.
This one, for people who watch, they like the change-ups here. President Bill Clinton baseball card.
When that Jacobs Field opened in 1994 in Cleveland, Bill Clinton threw out the first pitch, and I always remember I was in college. I was in John Carroll at the time. Wayne Kirby won that game against the Seattle Mariners with a walk-off single, I think, in the 11th inning. But everyone who's been around a while remembers where the Indians used to play at old Cleveland Municipal Stadium. It was one of the biggest sporting days in Cleveland history when Jacobs Field opened in 1994. My dad and I were fortunate enough to get tickets for it, and Bill Clinton threw out the first pitch.
Two more. We got Derek Jeter. You covered his final season.
Storybook. Every step of the way, ending with that walk-off single against the Orioles at Yankee Stadium, and then of course the final two at bats at Fenway Park, and coming off the field the only time he was ever cheered at Fenway.
And then last one. This is currently relevant, Trevor Bauer and what happened with ESPN.
Social media.
Yeah.
And outspoken. And, you know, something that you know, I know not everyone always agrees with what he has to say, but I'm glad that he's out there saying it, because this game needs as many personalities as possible.
So we've got 6 minutes left, so we've got about two questions. Let's see. Let's get one more audience one if we have it. I'll see here. Yeah, well, how about a thought on this? Billy Capullo says, when you spend most of the day writing, you don't have to talk to each other, so that's great for any marriage, as far as the New York writer couples.
Not wrong. I won't disagree with Billy.
And then – let's see. I think we got all of them, so that's pretty good. I had a couple more, but I figured we'd get people. So what have been some of your wow moments? What's been like the I made it exciting moment?
I would have to say, you know, there's probably a couple. In 2004, the U.S. Open was at Shinnecock Hills, and I was in my second year as a part-timer at Newsday. The very first U.S. Open that I ever remember watching on TV was 1986 when Raymond Floyd won, and that was at Shinnecock. And so that course always meant something to me, never envisioning as a kid that I would ever, you know, go to Shinnecock for any reason. It was kind of this, you know, mythical place, if you will, on the eastern end of Long Island, and obviously a stunning, anyone who's a golfer, you know, just an absolute stunning course. It's always ranked in the top, you know, five, usually top three in the country. But being assigned, and we had 12 or 14 riders that were assigned to the U.S. Open, so I was at the very low end of the totem pole. But the fact that I had a credential to cover the U.S. Open, my favorite golf event, at my favorite golf course, for a New York newspaper, even though I was still just a part-timer, I had a feeling like, wow, this is really something. And then the year I covered the Jets, I covered the Super Bowl. Obviously, the Jets weren't in it, but I did the Super Bowl. And I remember walking in the press box at Raymond James Stadium. It was a great game, Cardinals and Steelers, last-second touchdown reception by Santonio Holmes for the game winner. But I remember walking in the press box, and at that point, I was full-time and covering the Jets as a beat, and I guess established, if you, for lack of a better word. And I remember kind of looking around and saying, you know, wow, that's pretty cool.
So last question we ask everybody is, and we have 3 minutes. It's a tough, I'm not cutting you off. Instagram's going to cut us off at the hour, but what does baseball mean to you?
To me, the first thing that comes to mind is relationships. And somebody, I was doing a radio spot a few days ago, and the host asked, what do you miss the most? And it's something I really hadn't thought of, and probably something that I should have. And one of the things that I said was just the, you know, being lucky enough to do this for as long as I have, is, you know, there's just everyone in the game talks about the grind. And sometimes that has a negative connotation, but to me, it's actually a positive connotation, because, you know, I look at certain road trips and I know what restaurants I'm going to go to. I know what bars I'm going to go to. I know a security guard, let's say in Minneapolis, that you know, has been checking bags there for 40 years and always puts a smile on your face when you go through, or, you know, any number of scouts that I know, or, you know, I'm always going to see them, you know, for example, and, you know, may he continue to rest in peace, you know, T-Bone, who we all know and love, you know, always would see him in Tampa. And sometimes I actually would move my seat and I would cover the game and sit next to T-Bone and Charlie Relliford, the umpire supervisor, is always at Tropicana Field. You know, things like that. I can go on and on, because I'm lucky enough, in my 12th year, I've been to every ballpark at least once, and now I think at least three times. And so, you know, whatever city you name, whatever press box you name, whatever ballpark you name, you know, I can probably give you, like I said, a restaurant or a bar or someone there that I look forward to seeing every time we go. So, you know, when you say, what does baseball mean to you? You know, to me, it's, you know, it's relationships and a lifestyle that I dearly love.
Are we going with Boland's Bylines or Marley and Me?
Oh, man, they're both really good. But I guess I'm going to go with Boland's Bylines. Okay. Just because it's Sean.
Fair enough. All right. So,
and Jimmy, I can't let Jimmy's not nearly as funny as he thinks he is.
That's true. So we have our New York Pro Scouts contest going on right now. So for all you writers, all you fans, everybody that's watching, show us how you baseball. Show us what you're doing to keep baseball in your life. Tag us. We're giving out prizes, but we just want to show what the Northeast is doing for baseball. Erik, thank you so much. This has been Boland's Bylines, and we'll see everybody on Monday.
Thanks so much, guys.
Thanks a lot.